city of Mariupol.
U.S. House lawmakers approve a multi-billion dollar aid package for Ukraine.
And several members of a progressive group that supports presidential candidate Lenny Robredo arrested in Cavite Province.
Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, the foreign ministers of Ukraine and Russia failed to reach a ceasefire deal during talks in Turkey. Russian Minister Sergei Lavrov and Ukraine's Dmytro Kuleba met to explore the possibility of holding a 24-hour ceasefire to allow civilians or Ukrainian civilians to flee from invading Russian forces. But Kuleba says other decision makers in Russia may be in a better position to handle the matter.
The most tragic situation is currently now in the city of Mariupol, on the Sea of Azov. The city is being bombarded from the air. It's being hit by artillery fire. And I came here with a humanitarian purpose, to walk out from the meeting with the decision to arrange a humanitarian corridor in and from Mariupol for civilians who want to flee this area of fear and struggle, and humanitarian corridor to bring in Mariupol humanitarian aid.
Lavrov lashed out at Western countries for supplying weapons to Ukrainian forces. He claimed Moscow has no plans to attack other countries. The two ministers agreed to meet again, but have not specified where or when to do so.
Russia escalates its attacks on civilian areas of Ukraine, their latest target, a children's hospital. Ukraine's president has denounced the airstrike as genocide. More in this report.
Ukraine on Wednesday said a Russian airstrike badly damaged a children's hospital in the besieged city of Mariupol, burying patients under rubble and injuring women in labor. Video shot by the Ukraine military of what appeared to be the badly damaged children's and maternity hospital showed the wreckage of a three-story building. Piles of rubble and burnt-out cars were seen smoldering outside, and wounded people were carried from the destruction. Video posted on Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky's Instagram account showed the hospital interior piled with debris from broken windows, walls, and equipment. The bombing, which Zelensky called an atrocity, took place despite an agreed ceasefire to enable thousands of civilians trapped in the city to escape. The Kremlin denies targeting civilians. The White House condemned the assault. Press Secretary Jen Psaki.
It is horrifying to see the type of the barbaric use of military force to go after innocent civilians in a sovereign country.
Ukraine said 67 children across the country had been killed since the invasion, and more than 1,000 civilians had died in Mariupol. It was not possible to independently verify the figures. More than 2 million people have fled Ukraine since Russian President Vladimir Putin launched the invasion on February 24th. Ukraine continues to call for allies to imply a no-fly zone, but NATO has declined that request, fearing it could escalate the war. And on Wednesday, the Pentagon closed the door on Poland's proposal to put its MiG-29 fighter jets at the disposal of a U.S. military base in Germany in response to Ukraine's call for fighter jets. Pentagon spokesman John Kirby said the plan was not tenable.
The intelligence community has assessed that the transfer of MiG-29s to Ukraine may be mistaken as escalatory and could result in a significant Russian reaction that might increase the prospects of a military escalation with NATO.
Moscow says its demands, including that Kyiv takes a neutral position and drops aspirations of joining the NATO alliance, must be met for it to end its assault.
The alleged Russian bombing of a children's hospital in Ukraine is denied by Moscow as fake news. A Russian envoy to the United Nations claims the targeted facility was a former maternity hospital that had been taken over by Ukraine's military. He says Ukrainian troops in the building were firing on Russian forces.
The World Health Organization joins calls for peace in Ukraine as the Russian invasion disrupts the operations of the nation's healthcare facilities. The WHO says at least 10 people have died in over a dozen attacks on Ukraine's medical facilities. It warns infectious diseases may spread as Ukraine's humanitarian crisis worsens.
You put that many people in desperation on the move, women and children packed together, people in basements, people stressed, people not eating, not sleeping. These are the conditions in which immune systems are weak, people's defenses are low, and infectious diseases can rip through populations like this.
U.S. House lawmakers approve a massive spending bill which will supply some $13.6 billion in aid to Ukraine. This is double the initial request of $6.4 billion. The emergency funds are to be split evenly between military and humanitarian aid. Republicans and Democrats jointly applauded the measure in a rare display of bipartisanship. The measure now needs the signature of President Joe Biden.
Russian forces have already surrounded Ukraine's capital. The governor of the Kyiv region vows to die fighting as Russian forces try to occupy their homeland. This report.
New recruits to Ukraine's territorial defense forces in Kyiv got a lesson on Wednesday in newly arrived weaponry meant to punch a hole through a Russian tank. And this instructor, who only gave his name as Alex, told Reuters these men were ready to welcome the Russian army when it tries to take the city.
Russians can enter Kyiv, but they're not going to leave it. They're all going to burn up here.
Many expected Kyiv to quickly fall in the early days of the war. But 2 weeks into the Russian invasion, which Moscow calls a special military operation, Moscow's military missteps and tenacious Ukrainian resistance has kept the capital from changing hands.
Of course, we understand and see that the enemy wants to seize Kyiv. We understand that very well.
Oleksiy Kuleba is the governor of the Kyiv region.
Of course, they were not able to seize Kyiv immediately. Their aim was to do so in 2 or 3 days. This is a well-known fact. They failed because of the heroic actions of our armed forces and ordinary people who stood up to defend our city, our country.
He spoke to Reuters about the struggle ahead in almost apocalyptic terms.
For us, this is Judgment Day. It is a struggle between good and evil. And either way, we would die, but we would not let them seize our city.
Sounds and symbols of Ukrainian resolve spring up around the city. On Wednesday, the remaining musicians of the Kyiv Classic Symphony Orchestra performed the Ukrainian and European Union anthems. The show was broadcast live on Ukrainian TV. The conductor called the concert an action for peace. That is the message here. Praying for peace.
Слава Україні!
Героям слава!
Preparing for battle.
Philippine President Duterte is said to be willing to give America the use of its former military facilities in the country if the conflict in Europe spills over to Asia. Manila's envoy to Washington, Jose Manuel Romualdez, says former American bases in Clark, Pampanga, and Subic, Zambales may again host U.S. forces in line with a mutual defense treaty between the two countries.
If ever it's needed, the Philippines is ready to offer its whatever facilities or whatever things that the United States will need, being a major, our number one ally in using the facilities in the Philippines without any restrictions.
The Philippines earlier condemned Russia's invasion of Ukraine and called for an immediate end to the conflict.
Many Filipinos from Ukraine are still choosing to stay in other countries instead of returning to the Philippines. At least one Filipino refugee in Hungary insists the Philippine government's aid for returning Filipinos is not enough. Zen Hernandez has this story.
Casualties rise as Russian forces bombard civilian settlements in Ukraine, the latest of which was an airstrike that hit a maternity hospital in Mariupol, which Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky called an atrocity. As safe spaces diminish, more and more civilians try to flee frantically towards Western borders. Among those who crossed the border to Hungary is Filipino worker Regina.
Nakakuha naman po kami ng refugee status dito sa Hungary. We stay for 1 month and we can travel using the papers.
The Department of Foreign Affairs already appealed for Filipinos not to add to the ballooning refugee population in Europe. The Philippine Overseas Labor Office also reminded that regulations for employment remain the same. But Regina clarified her stay in Hungary is temporary.
Kung kaya ko po makapag-stay dito sa Hungary at makakuha ng trabaho for 1 month, at sa loob ng 1 month ay maging maayos ang Ukraine, babalik po ako doon.
The Philippine government has been unable to persuade Filipinos from Ukraine to come home despite assurances that there will be various forms of assistance from livelihood, scholarship, and re-employment or deployment. The DFA is also offering affected Filipinos $200, but for Regina, who is also a single mother of two, it is not easy to rely on limited government support.
Ang mother ko po Alzheimer po, may medicine po siya. Ang hirap po, may college po ako. Hindi po talaga sapat. Wala po akong sariling bahay, nangungupahan lang din po ako. Pag umuwi po ako sa Pilipinas, hindi naman po tatagal ng 2 months yung perang ibibigay ng government natin.
Based on the DFA's latest tally, 199 Filipinos have already evacuated from Ukraine. 136 have crossed the borders to 5 neighboring countries, but of this number, 100 are refusing to go back home. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
The International Energy Agency agrees to release 60 million barrels of oil reserves to compensate for supply disruptions due to the Ukraine conflict.
This was an initial response. It is only 4% of our stocks. If there is a need, if our government decides so, we can bring more oil to the markets as one part of the response. We are discussing with the producing countries in Middle East, in Latin America, in Asia, to encourage them to bring more oil to the markets to compensate the loss of Russian oil on a daily basis.
Global oil prices continued their wild ride Wednesday, with Brent crude dropping 13% to $111 per barrel. WTI crude also lost 12%, closing at $108 per barrel. The drop came after the United Arab Emirates said it will pump more oil into the market. Up next, Philippine anti-narcotics agents arrest members of a progressive group that supports the presidential bid of Lenny Robredo.
The World Tonight returns after the break.
Ngayong Biyernes.
First time you heard that Dad was running for the presidency, ano yung reaction niyo? Bashing is intense. Paano kayo nagre-react? Paano niyo ito nalalampasan?
ABS-CBN and the Boy Abunda Talk Channel present the interviews with the wives and children of the 2022 presidential candidates with Boy Abunda, featuring Jinky, Princess, and Queenie Pacquiao.
Maraming nagsasabi na hindi siya qualified. Alam ni Lord kung gaano ka pure ang intention ni Manny at yung sinceridad.
March 11, 6 p.m. sa The Boy Abunda Talk Channel at 11 p.m. sa Kapamilya Channel. Movies to watch.
We're back on The World Tonight. Philippine anti-narcotics agents arrest several activists who have been actively campaigning for presidential bet Lenny Robredo and her running mate, Kiko Pangilinan. The militant group Anak Pawi says some of its members were nabbed in their Cavite homes in a supposed anti-drug operation Thursday. Anak Pawi's national president, Ariel Casilao, also says there were other activists arrested in Laguna province. Casilao denies the Anak Pawi's members are involved in illegal drugs. The human rights group Karapatan points out the arrests were made after a Cavite lawmaker and Senator Pantilo Lacson red-tagged the crowd which joined Robredo's campaign rally in Cavite last week. ANC has reached out to the Philippine National Police for more details on the anti-drug operation. They have yet to respond to our request for comment.
Vice President Robredo's camp belies Senator Pantilo Lacson's claim of a supposed coalition government with the communist movement being planned if Robredo wins the presidential race. Robredo's spokesperson Barry Gutierrez says to lead to a, quote, absurd conclusion based on self-serving reports is the height of irresponsibility. Gutierrez adds, while the Robredo campaign has seen more than its fair share of attacks, the blatant and persistent red tagging is a new low. Antonio Trillanes, who is part of Robredo's senatorial slate, also hit Lacson, saying his intelligence sources are wrong. Trillanes also insists he and Robredo will not allow communists to infiltrate her campaign.
The Aksyon Demokratiko Party, a Philippine presidential bet, and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno Domagoso continues to go after the 203 billion peso real estate tax debt of the family of the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos. The party's chairman, Ernest Ramel, wrote the Presidential Commission on Good Government to verify a claim made by a spokesman of Marcos's son and namesake. Attorney Vic Rodriguez had said the PCGG and the Internal Revenue Bureau had agreed to wait for a decision on the case before doing any collection enforcement activities. Ramel says if proven to be true, details of the deal should be disclosed.
Bakit parang ginawang hush-hush, no? Wala man lang lumabas na press release about it or any notification sa bayan na meron palang ganun mga agreements, parang bakit parang nililihim yata o may galaw na dapat alam ng bayan dahil ang ating mamamayan, ang Pilipino ang nakikinabang sa estate tax na to eh.
Aksyon Demokratiko also wrote the Internal Revenue Bureau on Monday to ask if it had issued written demands to the Marcos family to urge them to pay their estate tax debt. It has yet to receive any response.
Here's our campaign brief for Thursday. The Robredo Pangilinan tandem wooed voters in Romblon. They visited a community learning hub and met with fisherfolk. They ended the day with a people's rally attended by thousands of residents. Vice presidential bet Sara Duterte campaigned in Quezon City where she visited vendors and tricycle drivers. The Davao City mayor also met with senior citizens and members of the group LGBT Pilipinas. Manila Mayor Isko Moreno holds a town hall meeting in Nueva Ecija where he discussed several issues including the rising oil prices. He was joined by his running mate Dr. Willie Ong and their senatorial slate. And Senator Pantilo Lacson goes to Parañaque. Prior to his campaign activities, he met with Mayor Edwin Olivares at the City Hall.
There's a new coronavirus hybrid. It's dubbed Deltacron. The strain has genes from both the Delta and Omicron variants. The World Health Organization confirms Deltacron is already in some European countries like France, but it says it has not seen any changes in the severity of COVID-19. The WHO says testing must be continued to control the spread of the virus.
WHO is concerned that several countries are drastically reducing testing. This inhibits our ability to see where the virus is, how it's spreading, and how it's evolving. Testing remains a vital tool in our fight against the pandemic as part of a comprehensive strategy.
The Philippine Health Department says it is closely monitoring if Deltacron will be detected in the country.
The Philippines kicks off the fourth round of its national COVID-19 vaccination drive as nearly 100 million doses in its vaccine stockpile remain unused. The country's health chief says there are also plans to donate excess jabs to other nations. More from Vivian Gulia.
As the Philippines begins the fourth round of the national COVID vaccination drive, Health Secretary Francisco Duque III cautions the public against complacency. One of the reasons he sees for the low uptake of COVID booster shots and the recent slowdown in COVID vaccination in the country.
May complacency ang mga tao. Una-una, tingin ng mga tao. Ewan ko, yun lang ang tingin namin. Ano? Na dahil nga, of course, napag-alaman, mild ang Omicron.
The health chief reminds Filipinos that depending on possible virus mutations, a COVID surge remains a constant threat. That is why he appeals to the public to get vaccinated or boosted once eligible. Duque issued this statement during the ceremonial vaccination for NVD4, which targets to jab 1.8 million individuals ages 12 years old and above in 3 days. At the Philippine Medical Association office in Quezon City, more than 100 individuals lined up Thursday morning to get a COVID jab. This figure is far from the site's capacity of administering 1,000 COVID jabs a day. It accepts walk-ins who are eligible for a first dose, second dose, or a booster shot.
First and second dose ko kasi Moderna, kaya alam ko na kung ano yung mangyayari sa akin. Kasi ano lang, wala lang naman eh. Yung nilagdat lang ako isang araw, ganun.
Tapos, okay na.
Okay na.
At St. Peter and John Parish in Malabon, more individuals lined up in the afternoon compared to its morning vaccination. Unlike previous rounds when vaccinations during the NVD were primarily held in mega-jabbing sites, the government has shifted its strategy to bring the inoculation closer to the public through private clinics, workplaces, and house-to-house initiatives. That's on top of COVID vaccinations done in schools, malls, and gymnasiums. The country has fully vaccinated against COVID close to 64 million individuals, or 71% of the eligible population, while nearly 10.7 million received a booster or additional dose. Of the 233.8 million COVID vaccine doses that arrived in the country, over 96 million have yet to be administered as of March 9th. Duque says vaccine maker AstraZeneca has extended the shelf life of 12 to 13 million of its COVID jabs in the country by another 3 months. This is awaiting approval from the Philippine FDA. The country plans to donate some excess vaccines to other nations.
Yung hindi magagamit at malapit na mag-expire, ang desisyon dyan ay i-donate sa mga bansang mababa ang vaccine coverage. At maganda naman yan, layunin na iyan para makatulong din tayo sa mga kapatid natin mula sa mga ibang bansa na namamayagpag pa din ang COVID-19.
The number of vaccine doses to be donated is still being finalized, but among the countries being eyed to receive them are Cambodia, Myanmar, and some countries in Africa. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Hotel owners in the Philippines say the government owes them some 1.7 billion pesos for accommodating returning overseas Filipinos. The Philippine Hotel Owners Association is calling on the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration to pay its debt so that affected hotels can sustain their operations.
Meron naman pong nailaan na pondo, no, para sa mga ano, sa pagbayad dito sa amin. Kasi yung 1.7 billion malaki-laki po itong ano, itong amount na ito.
Opo.
Sana maintindihan din nila na kailangan din kasi namin ng ng pondo para ma-cover yung mga operating expenses namin. Ang pinakamalaki po naming expenses diyan sa power, no, electricity, at saka mahalaga yung pagpapasweldo sa aming mga workers.
The OWA assures the affected hotel owners that their concerns will be addressed, but it is appealing for patience as they wait for the cash to be disbursed.
South Korean select conservative opposition candidate Yoon Suk-yeol as their new president in one of the most closely fought races in recent history. Details in this report.
South Korea has a new president. Conservative opposition candidate Yoon Suk-yeol was elected in one of the most closely fought races in recent history, which will shape Asia's fourth largest economy for the next 5 years. Yoon, who is 60, edged out the ruling Democratic Party's Lee Jae-myung by a fraction. A formal announcement is expected to be made on Thursday. The People Power Party candidate said he would work with opposition parties to heal polarized politics and foster national unity, calling the election a, quote, victory of the great people.
승리가 아닌가 그렇게 생각을 합니다.
Yoon's 5-year term will begin this month to replace incumbent President Moon Jae-in, who is constitutionally barred from seeking re-election. The White House congratulated Yoon, saying President Joe Biden looked forward to working closely with him to bolster the alliance. Despite being a political novice, Yoon shot to fame after spearheading high-profile investigations into corruption scandals engulfing Moon's aides.
이제 우리는 이런 부패하고
We have to stop the corrupt and incompetent ruling forces' attempt to extend their term and plunder people.
He has pledged to stamp out graft, foster justice, and create a more level playing field while seeking a reset with China and a tougher stance towards reclusive North Korea. More than 77% of South Korea's 44 million eligible voters cast ballots to pick their next leader, despite an unprecedented surge in new COVID-19 cases, with a record 342,446 posted on Wednesday.
Philippine shares recover for a second straight day after seeing sharp losses earlier this week. The rest of Asian markets also higher amid talks between Russia and Ukraine. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets climbed on Thursday as oil prices dropped, U.S. crude by 12%, Brent by 13%, easing concerns the war in Ukraine will stoke already hot inflation. Though economists point out the fluctuation in oil prices was influenced by shifts in futures contracts and other factors, warning commodities will stay volatile while Russia and Ukraine prepare to meet for another round of negotiations. But it's not just geopolitical tensions in Eastern Europe oil players are monitoring. Phoenix Petroleum's Bongfa de Leon shares they're getting mixed signals from other suppliers as well.
I was just informed there was a post from Chinese regulators that exports, those who hold export quotas, are being restrained from fulfilling their export requirements for April. So while you have OPEC members saying that they will increase supply into the market, you've got somebody sending mixed signals, China for that matter, which is a dominant supplier in the region, saying that they will withhold exports. So for the Philippines, a significant amount of our exports come from China. So That's where the pinch happens.
For now, the PSE index joined the relief rally up 1.9% back above 7,100. In corporate stories, A-REIT, the country's first ever REIT, will boost its portfolio to 64 billion pesos through an 11 billion peso property for share swap. Its second would sponsor Ayala Land. This involves 6 Cebu-based office buildings in exchange for some 252 million A-REIT primary common shares. The buildings have a total gross leasable area of 124,000 square meters with a 97% occupancy rate leased by major BPOs. Post-transaction, A-REIT's dividend per share is projected to increase further from 1.77 for 2021, which is already up 34% from 2020 figures and 12% higher than its original projection during the IPO. Meanwhile, CITICOR Energy REIT, or C-REIT, the country's first energy REIT, is expanding its portfolio, injecting properties in Bulacan and South Cotabato, collectively worth around $2.4 billion. Both properties seen contributing 21% to C-REIT's total lease revenues, and bringing total operating capacity of all tenants to 145 megawatts from pre-IPO capacity of 124. C-REIT's target is to hit 780 megawatts by 2025. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Sam Levinson. We may not always see eye to eye, but we can try to see heart to heart.
And that is The World Tonight, the 10th of March, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!
ang nakaraan.